Good to have you guys here. We're almost to the lowest. We hit bottom last week. We're going to stay there this week, and then see Moses hit bottom here. And then it'll be a gentle uptrend after that in terms of like we're going to do the stories, etc. So it's just more somber food for thought is what we're going to explore this week. So let me open up with a word of prayer.
Priesthood
rebelling against Moses and Aaron and the other priests, saying, "Who are you guys? You're not so special. All of God's people are holy, and they can all be priests, when in fact Israel is shown that it's not all capable of being a holy and priestly people." So verse 35, we're just in the middle of the story here. Remember, earth swallowed up that whole crew of rebels, Korah and everybody, and then there were a whole bunch of them also in rebellion, standing there with censers offering incense. In verse 35, at the end of last week, fire came out from Yahweh and consumed the men who were offering incense. You guys with me? Okay. It's just, it's been 7 days. I don't assume you've been thinking about this the entire time since we were last week. So, Yahweh said to Moses, verse 36, "Tell Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, to take the censers out of the smoldering remains." So remember, the censers are these metal handheld objects. I think if you hold it under a handle, some kind of little platform, and then carries, or container that carries coals and then incense and mixed goods and stuff like that. And so these 250 rebels just got toasted, but the metal censers are there on the ground. So go pick up the censers out of the smoldering remains. Who wants that job? It's a horrible job. And scatter the coals some distance away, because the censers are holy. The censers of the men who sinned at the cost of their lives. Hammer those censers into sheets. They're made out of gold. So heat them up, hammer it all out into flat sheets, thin sheets of gold, and overlay the altar, the main altar where they make all the sacrifices. For they were presented before Yahweh, and they have become holy. And let them be a sign to the Israelites. So Eleazar the priest collected all the, bronze censers brought by those who had been burned up, and he had hammered out to overlay the altar, as Yahweh directed him through Moses. This was to remind the Israelites that no one except a descendant of Aaron could come to burn incense before Yahweh, if he would become like Korah and his followers. So again, remember to get the right picture here. All of this is, remember we have the different kinds of sin here. We had unintentional sin, like, oops, I celebrated Sabbath on the wrong day. Oops, didn't mean to, my alarm didn't go off. So that's unintentional sin. But then you have what is called intentional sin. Do you remember the little phrase for that? Sin with a... Israelite community did what? they grumbled again against Moses and Aaron, saying, "You have killed Yahweh's people." And then just stop and think about that. So look back at the first, just go back to the 16. So remember 16 began with these different groups within the priesthood of the Levites, Korah, some Kohath, some Levi, Levi, other Reubenites, those guys, they rose up against Moses. Verse 3, they came as a group to oppose Moses, saying, "You've gone too far, the whole community is whole." So here is this rebellion within the priesthood. Now you have the whole Israelite people now coming with a high hand against Moses, saying, "You, Moses and Aaron, you guys, I don't know why that's happening, you guys have killed Yahweh's people." Now, technically, is that true or not true? Think back to the story of Israel. Did Moses and Aaron just kill all of those people? No. Who did? That way. And just to make it perfectly clear, was it arbitrary, random wrath of Yahweh just taking out people and felt like that? No, it was a clear response to rebellion against Yahweh. So that's not true at all. So clearly there's a disconnect here. And it's going to get even more crazy. It's as if the more rebellious and hateful they become towards Yahweh, the more irrational they get, that they can't see what that is happening. So verse 42, "But when the assembly gathered in opposition to Moses and Aaron, and they turned toward the tent of meeting, suddenly a cloud covered the tent, and the glory of Yahweh appeared," which, you know, at the end of Exodus was a really good thing. Okay, Yahweh's coming to dwell with his people. And you've noticed that in each of the rebellion narratives, Yahweh's presence comes down and he's here to deal with the problem, with rebellion. So Moses and Aaron went to the front of the tent of meeting. And Yahweh said to Moses, not for the first time, "Get away from this assembly, so I can put an end to them at once." It's worth going through and counting how many times Israel signed its own death sentence before Yahweh because of these kinds of things. And each time Yahweh brings some form of justice but never steps out of completely. So Moses and Aaron, they fell face down. Then Moses said to Aaron, "Take your censer and put incense on it, along with fire from the altar, and hurry into the assembly to make atonement for them." So you have whole Israelite people now grumbling against Moses. "You're the murderers, you're the bad guys." Very similar to 11, where they're like, "Let's get a new leader, let's go back to Egypt, let's reverse the Exodus. This is all a really bad idea," and so on. And so they fall face down in front of the tent. Aaron has a censer. Oh, this is happening. This is totally happening for him. So Aaron has a censer and he runs into the middle of the mass of Israel to make atonement for them. Now he's got a censer in his hand. What would normally you think he should have in his hand if he's going to make atonement? How do you normally get atonement for sin, say according to the book? As an animal, a sacrificial animal. So this is interesting. This is one of two, I forget, maybe three stories in the whole Hebrew Bible where atonement is made through a non-animal sacrifice. And so it's something to do with censer. So, hurry to the assembly. Make atonement for them. Wrath has come out from Yahweh, and the plague has started. So Aaron did as Moses said. He ran into the midst of the assembly. The plague had already started among the people. But Aaron offered incense and made atonement for them with the incense. And where he stood, as he went into the mass of people, he has the offering of incense that makes atonement. And where he stood between the living and the dead. And the plague stopped. It's as if he was racing the plague, and then he got to his forefront, and then it stopped. But 14,700 people died from the plague. In addition to those who had died because of Torah. Then Aaron returned to Moses at the entrance to the tent of meeting. The plague had stopped. 17 just flows right into the same story, so let's keep going. And then we'll make some questions. Yahweh said to Moses, "Speak to the Israelites and give 12 staffs from them, one for each leader of each of their ancestral tribes, and write the name of each man, maybe the leader of each tribe, on the staff. And on the staff of Levi, write Aaron's name. For there must be one staff for the head of each ancestral tribe. And place them in the tent of meeting." Take them into the tent of tabernacle. Right in front of the testimonies. Take them into the holy of holies, where I meet them. "The staff belonging to the man I choose will sprout. And I will rid myself of this constant grumbling against you by the Israelites." So Moses spoke to the Israelites, their leaders. They gave him the 12 staffs. Staves. That's it. Never mind. Question. Staves. One for the leader of each of their ancestral tribes. And Aaron's staff was right there. Moses placed the staffs before Yahweh in the tent. The next day, Moses entered the tent of the testimony, and he saw that Aaron's staff, which represented the house of Levi, it had not only sprouted, but had budded and blossomed and produced almonds. Then Moses brought out all of the staffs from Yahweh's presence to all of the Israelites. They looked at them. Each one took his own staff and was like, "I didn't get almonds. What is that?" You know, I got almonds, but I didn't get almonds. Yahweh said to Moses, "Put Aaron's staff right in front of the testimony, and it will be kept as a sign to the rebellious. This will put an end to their grumbling against me, so that they will not die." Moses did just as Yahweh commanded him. Okay, stop right there. Don't look at verse 12. That's kind of a dumb song, but don't look at verse 12. So, Jesus, I mean, it's kind of self-evident here. It's a very unique, odd little story here. You have the priest rebel. Yahweh brings justice on that rebellion. And then the whole Israelite people get totally irrational and think Moses and Aaron are going around trying to murder everybody. And so Yahweh says, enough. Absolutely enough. And as every time, he brings justice, he brings an act of judgment on the people. And it's in the form of this plague. And that's severe. So, personally, that's just way too intense for me. I'm sure it's really intense for you too, but it's the Bible. There you go. We have to process that. And this is nothing new. This is not arbitrary. It's not random. If anything, from all of these stories, I think the biggest thing that we need to see is that Yahweh's judgment is never arbitrary. It's never random. And what we focused on last week was Israel is taking the heaviest hit right here because of because Israel is, out of all the nations of the earth, the people that Yahweh has drawn closest to himself. And the more he draws this group of people close to himself, the more they rebel and start pushing back against him. And so they face heavy, heavy consequences for that. And so Yahweh first offers this sign, a reminder of the censers, the metal that got placed over the altar, and they irrationally rebelled against that. And so there's this plague that comes on the people. And notice, the people, this whole rebellion was against Aaron and the priesthood. And who ends up saving the people at the end of chapter 16? Aaron, as the priest. It's as if the people are rebelling against the very thing Yahweh has put in their midst so that they can be saved. And then the whole thing about the budding of the almond blossoms and so on. It's just such a unique little story. There's nothing like this. And like, why almonds? Yeah, nobody knows. I mean, it's just a little detail in the story. Why wasn't it dates? Something like that. I have no idea. What was some other kind of fruit? Nobody knows. But it's this very unique image where the priesthood is this source of life among the people. It's the way that these people, this is all the way back, reaching to the Leviticus. It's the way that, remember, God's holiness is his purity and power and goodness is the author of all life and goodness. And then you have the world of the profane or the defiled, which is connected with death and sin. So you have this clash here, because Yahweh wants to bring people into his presence, but you have this clash between our sin and death. And so the priesthood becomes this stand-in group here that can make this not kill you. In fact, sacrifices can be offered in your place, atonement can be made, and you can enter in and experience life. And so you get this little imagery. I'm so sorry. I'm just really sorry. It hurt your ears. Last time, you know, this was a sign that Mike was dying. Last time. I don't know what to do. I'm trying not to move my head. This is really hard. So, whatever the almond blossoms mean, the point is it's just little sign of beauty out of these really miserable stories of judgment, people dying, bearing the cost of their own sin. And then you get this mediator between God and the people, and this little source of flowers and life in the middle of the story. Which I understood what was happening. Okay, so you have Yahweh designating once again the priesthood. What's the people's response to this here? Luke verse 12. What's the people's response? The Israelites said to Moses, "We're dying. We're going to die. We're all going to die. We're going to die. We're lost. We perished. We're all lost." Anybody? Well, I guess we're doing audio. You want to? Batteries. Batteries.
I mean, there's just a play, you know, and we saw the first of all the rebellious priests.
But notice they go to the other extreme then, of anybody who even attempts to come near. Now is that true? Is that true? If you're going to offer a sacrifice for yourself, what do you have to do? You have to take it to the priest. And they're going to go actually into the holy tabernacle and so on and drink the blood and all that kind of thing. But it's not the case that anybody would even hear. So this is the scene. And then all of a sudden we're like, oh, what's going to happen? And then boom, two long chapters of law is right here. Just kills the law. But the law is Yahweh said to Aaron, you, your sons, and your father's family are to bear this gate. So the Lord said to Aaron, you, your sons, and your father's family, who's that? Who's the you? Right here. Who? Yahweh said to Aaron, you. Aaron, your sons, priesthood, and your father's family, that is the Levites. You all are to bear the responsibility for offenses against the sanctuary. And you and your sons alone are to bear the responsibility for offenses against the priesthood. Now just stop. Stop. This is such an easy thing to read over. It might strike you once you do that. So if there's anybody who waltzes into the tabernacle and they're in a state of impurity, or they murder someone and they haven't confessed it, or if somebody offends the priesthood, you can think of a story where that's that priesthood.
Oh yes.
So you have Levites, or the whole people of Israel, up against Aaron and Moses and so on. So from now on, who is going to bear the cost of rebellion against the priesthood? Look closely. Who's going to bear the cost of that? Now who bore the cost of it in 16 and 17? The whole community. Who suffered from the plague when they rose up against Moses and Aaron? And said, you are the murderers of the people. Who bore the consequences? That so the people. Now, who's going to bear the consequences of Israel's rebellion against the priests?
The priests. It's a very precarious place to find yourself if you're a priest.
Right? So what? Bring your fellow Levites from your ancestral tribe to join you and assist you when you and your sons minister before the tent. They are to be responsible to you. They are to perform all the duties of the tent, but they must not go near the furnishings of the sanctuary of the altar. Remember, the Levites as a whole are facilities and maintenance for the tent. And the priests themselves are the ones who so they are not to go near the furnishings, the sanctuary, the altar, or both they and you will die. So, you know, the Levite, who's like, I don't want to just sweep the courtyard. I want to do the Day of Atonement thing. And that guy waltzes into, you know, the Holy of Holies. He's going to get consumed by Yahweh's purity and power. But who also will bear the cost of that Levite's folly and rebellion?
Aaron, this is a raw deal.
Verse 4. They are to join you and be responsible for the care of the tent. Amen. All the work of the tent. No one else may come near where you are. You're to be responsible for the care of the sanctuary and the altar, so that wrath will not fall on the Israelites again. I myself have selected your fellow Levites from among the Israelites as a gift to you, dedicated to facilities and maintenance of the temple. But only you and your sons may serve as priests in connection with everything at the altar inside the curtain. I am giving you the service of the priesthood as a gift. Anyone else who comes near the sanctuary must be put to death. What follows, I'm going to summarize a bit here, what follows in verses 8 and following is then, it's just repeating stuff we already read in Leviticus. It's about how the tithe, where the Israelites giving one-tenth of their produce and bringing their animal offerings and so on, that is how the priests survive and live. Go down to verse 21. I give to the Levites all the tithes in Israel as their inheritance in return for the work they do while serving the tent. From now on, the Israelites must not go near the tent of meeting, which go near doesn't mean you can't bring a sacrifice. It just means if you're not coming to bring a sacrifice, you can't just waltz into the tabernacle. They can't go near the tent of meeting, for they will bear the consequences of their sin, and they will die. It is the Levites who are to do the work in the tent of meeting and bear the responsibility for offenses against them. So, verse 3 again. The Levites, they work in the tent of meeting. Who bears the responsibility of people violating the Holy Spirit? The Levites. This is the lasting ordinance for generations to come. They will receive no inheritance among the Israelites except by the tithes. Instead, I give to the Levites their inheritance, the tithes that Israel then is offering. Yeah. And then go down to verse 30. Say to the Levites, when you present the best part of the tithe and offering, it will be reckoned to you as a product of threshing floor of the wine press. You and your household, you can eat the rest of it anywhere. That's your pay. You live off of the tithe offering for your work. By presenting the best part of it, Yahweh, you will not be guilty in this matter. You will defile the holy offerings and you will die. So there's key themes going on here, right here. And it really just points to this. So clearly these narratives are underscoring the key thing that Paul the Apostle summarized in Romans chapter 3, which is very familiar, that Yahweh isn't an arbitrary, false god, like Greek gods like Zeus, he doesn't just reign, curses on your life when he feels like it. Always know where and why you stand with Yahweh. And if you, in terms of the story here, if you rebel, if you violate the covenant, Yahweh is committed to forgive, and stay committed to the covenant of the family, that any given generation may suffer the consequences for this sin. And in all of these stories, when people rebel, they die. And so you have this tension. Narratives are all exploring the tension. You have the goodness and the life of God trying to draw screwed up people into himself in this clash and this conflict. And so the first time we thought this animal sacrifices fills this gap here. But now he also is standing in the gap here with their lives on the line. Not just lambing, little lambing, right? And sheep. Who else? No. The priest and the Levite. Yeah. So you have this portrait here. There's this huge conflict. Israel keeps rejecting the living God, trying to draw into himself. And so you have this hint here that animal sacrifices, the animal dying in your place, its blood, its life, your life, that kind of thing. We have that in Leviticus. But how's that working out? Reminding Israelites of their sin, being really repentant. It's not working. It's not working. And so it's as if the stakes get ratcheted up even more, where the priesthood itself will bear the cost of Israel's sin against the tabernacle. Does that make sense what's going on there? Like, we might think that's crazy. And it is crazy. It's probably crazy. But the point is, this flow of the story is telling you, first of all, this is not working, people. We need someone or something that can truly transform the hearts of the people and some kind of way to solve this conflict. Right? Now, what does Moses say to solve all this? In Ruth chapter 11, what did he say? Oh, I wish that all of the obvious people had what?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit. Just come here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. This for you. You can just write it down. There's a couple little comments in Hebrews chapter 9, which, by the way, go read Hebrews sometime after all this time has been in the book of Numbers, and things will fire that have not fired before. There's a couple little lines where he's trying to depict the meaning of the cross, and he's showing how the cross, one of the things the cross is doing, same thing that David Clement was doing, except way better than David Clement ever did. So this is Hebrews chapter 9, verse 6. He says, when everything had been arranged in the tabernacle, the priests entered regularly into the outer room to carry on their ministry. But the high priest, he entered the inner room, and that only once a year, and never without blood, which he offered for himself and people that committed ignorance. The Holy Spirit was showing by this that the way into the most holy place had still not yet been disclosed as long as the first tabernacle was still functioning. It's an illustration for the present time, indicating that the gifts sacrifices being offered weren't able to clear the conscience of the worshiper. Their matters of food and drink and ceremonial washings, external regulations, applying until the time of the new work. Now, when he says the Holy Spirit was shunning by this, what does he mean? It's really interesting. So what he's saying is, listen, the Day of Atonement, sins get taken care of for another year. But what do you know you're going to have to do another year from now? Another day of atonement. Because what for sure is going to accumulate in the next 365 days? A lot more sin. And so these stories are doing much the same thing. I mean, we have the Day of Atonement here. And then what keeps happening is like this repetition. So when he says the Holy Spirit is showing, I think essentially what the author of Hebrews is saying is if you actually read the storyline in Pentateuch, you'll see that the story is trying to tell you that animal sacrifices aren't working. Not working. And that's what the Holy Spirit is telling you through the story. And now in Numbers 18, the stakes get even higher because the priests themselves, their lives are on the line too. So, it's perfect. Segue to chapter number 19, verse 11. But when Christ, when Messiah came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands, that is to say, not a part of this creation. He did not enter by the means of blood of goats and calves. He entered the most holy place once and for all by his own blood, obtaining eternal redemption. The blood of goats and of bulls and the ashes of a heifer. Look at Numbers chapter 19. What's Numbers chapter 19? Oh, it's about this ritual about the ashes of a red heifer. Trying to take off the next word. So we'll talk about sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean, and it sanctifies them so that they're outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Messiah, who through the eternal Spirit, offer himself unblemished to God, and cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we can actually serve the living God. You see how he's making all the potentials here. So the story is trying to show you that this, we're putting animals, and even putting priests in here, is not the ultimate to solve the problem. What we need is one priest who will do for all of us what we can never do for ourselves, not for himself. In the power of the Spirit, and then that same Spirit comes to start messing with you to shape your heart so that we can begin to actually experience life change and everything. Come on, this is good news. It's just good, it's good news by talking about heifers and bulls and goats and lambs, but that's what we're talking about. Number 19, you ready, Rocket? Because I really want to do 20 next week. Ready? Yahweh said to Moses and Aaron, "This is the requirement of the law that Yahweh has commanded. Tell the Israelites to bring you a red heifer without, now red, I just because I was curious yesterday, so I just Googled red cow, and I got a lot of different images. I got like a little Lego thing here. Cartoons. But here we go. So by red it means reddish brown. That's the idea. It's not a human cow or anything like that, but red, reddish brown. Okay with me? Yeah. Reddish brown heifer, i.e. a female cow, without defect or blemish, that has never been under a yoke, so it's still a prime. Give it to Eleazar the priest, and take it outside the camp. It's to be taken outside the camp and slaughtered in his presence. Now this is strange. We've never had a sacrifice outside the camp. Usually it's all at the altar, right? Then Eleazar the priest is to take some of the blood on his finger and sprinkle it seven times toward the front of the tent. While he watches, the heifer is to be burned up, tied its flesh, its blood, its offal. How do you pronounce that? Offal. The poop, the waste from the intestines. The priest is to take some of the cedar wood, hyssop, and the scarlet wool, and throw them onto the burning heifer. Those fresh cedar would be kind of orangish red. Scarlet wool, it's also red, it's got this red theme. Throw them onto the burning heifer. After that, the priest must wash his clothes, bathe himself in water. He may then come into the camp, remember this is all taking place outside the camp, but he will be ceremonially unclean until evening. The man who burns it must also wash his clothes, bathe with water, and he too will be unclean until evening. Now, if a man who is clean, separate priest now, is to go gather up all the ashes and put them in a ceremonially clean place outside the camp. The ashes are to be kept by the Israelite community for use in the water of cleansing. This is all directions for making this water that you're going to pour the ash into, which I guess will turn into be like a little paste. Ash and water, cleansing paste, actually. Sounds very spa-like, something bad. Anyway, so verse 10, the man who gathers up the ashes of the heifer, he must also wash his clothes, and then he'll be cleansing. Do you think this is the last importance? Both for the Israelites and for the immigrants that are among them. What do you do with this cleansing paste? Whoever touches the dead body of anyone will be unclean for 7 days. He must purify himself with
water that is taste. Like saying cleansing taste. Cleansing taste on the third day and on the seventh day. And then if he doesn't purify himself on the third day and the seventh day, he won't. Whoever touches the dead body of anybody who fails to purify himself defiles Yahweh's tabernacle, that person must be cut off from Israel. Because the cleansing taste has not been sprinkled on him, he's unclean. Now, we've had this once in Leviticus. You remember there's a number of things that if you touch them, you'll be unclean. Or ceremonially impure. It simply means that you can't go, puts you into this status here. This is again a symbolic system where death is associated with anti-life or anti-goodness. And so if you have been in contact with death, you can't just go into the vaults in here. There needs to be some way of dealing with that. And so here, it's these ashes of this red female cow. It gets burned and then turned into a cleansing paste. The cleansing paste gets put on you. And this symbolically makes you clean to be able to come to God's presence. This is very similar. All of this is similar all the way back to the garden, where once humanity has rebelled and is subject to death, then they're expelled, so to speak, from the garden. And again, it's not because you're always a jerk. Remember, what's my main go-to metaphor for holiness, God's holiness? It's the sun. So the sun's not a jerk for burning you if you don't put on sunscreen. The sun is the sun. And it's like we exist because of the sun. You would exist without the same power of the sun that would burn you if you don't put on sunscreen. So it's Israel having all of these reminders who they are, who God is, and that they live by His holiness, and that He's moved toward them in His holiness, and that He's provided means for them to come into His presence. So, that's if you touch the dead body. This is the law that applies when a person dies in a tent. Anyone who enters that tent, and anyone in it, will also be unclean for 7 days. So maybe you didn't touch the dead body, but you were in the presence, like in the same house. Every open container without a lid fastened on it, that's in a tent where the person died, will be unclean for 7 days. Again, this is all where we're tempted to be like, it's weird, it's archaic. But I sure hope, you wouldn't fly to another country and like look at how they do rituals of death and family and stuff like that. And be like, oh, you're weird. That's weird. Why do you do that? And then be like, you're an arrogant American, go back home. That's it. So, yeah, we have to just check our kind of cultural lens. Their whole cultural symbol system to remind themselves of these core truths that death and sin are such tragic realities, and they're so not who God is and what God wants for us, that we need to mark these moments, we need to somehow account for them, sacrifice and cleansing, to recognize God's goodness and how he wants to be with us. That's what I think is going on. So, verse 17. For the unclean person who puts ashes from the burned purification offering into a jar, and you pour fresh water over them. The man who's ceremonially clean just takes some hyssop, dip it into the paste water, and sprinkle the tent and all the furnishings and all the people who were there. So the whole house gets a good tasting. He must also sprinkle anyone who's touched a human bone, or a grave, or someone who's been killed, or someone who's died a natural death. Also, can you think of why this law is here? What has there been a lot of in the last few chapters? A lot of people dying. And so, this is
surely that's why this chapter is put right here. It's because they're living now in the midst of a lot of tragedy and death. So again, God's providing means for them to still remain in His presence. So there's all these ways, graves and bones and dead people and tents. So verse 19, the man who is clean is to sprinkle the unclean person, just go get some of the paste, and sprinkle the unclean person on the third day and on the seventh day. On the seventh day, he's purified. That person being cleansed and washes clothes, bathes with water, and that evening will be clean. If a person who is unclean doesn't purify himself, he must be cut off from the community to defile the sanctuary of the Lord. The water of cleansing is not to sprinkle on unclean. This is the lasting importance. So you guys get the idea here. You have, this is strange, included. This is strange to read this and be like, oh, God's so good and gracious. Right? Because it doesn't feel that way to us. But in the story, I think that is what's going on here. You have people constantly rebelling. You have God saying this isn't working. You have just animal sacrifices. So the stakes are higher. Now the priests themselves are going to bear consequences also. And then God provides the means to cleanse him from all of the bad.
Yes.